السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه واقتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We continue with the next episode of the seerah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And again, another one, this part also having to do with the Battle of Badr during Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's second year after Hijrah with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum in the most illustrious battles of Islam. So now we've been discussing for some time regarding the payment of ransom that was taken by Sahaba radiallahu anhum by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is the decision that was made and it was ultimately agreed upon. We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send down revelation to reproach Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam or the Sahaba radiallahu anhum for this decision that they had taken. Nevertheless, amongst those who were held captives as prisoners of war, the 70 from amongst the disbelievers from the Battle of Badr, there was a few that were distinguished. There were a few that were special. And some of these individuals would of course later on go on to embrace Islam. But nevertheless, from amongst those who were also held as captives, as prisoners of war, with the Muslims, with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, was a man who was the son-in-law to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This man, this individual's name, Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah. Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah was married to Zainab radiallahu anha. Zainab radiallahu anha was the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from Khadijatul Kubra radiallahu anha. So there's Zainab, there is Ruqayya, there's Ummi Kulthum, and there is Fatima. These are the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam from Khadijatul Kubra radiallahu anha, whose names we have to become familiar with by now. And then the sons, there's Tayyib, Qasim, Ibrahim, Abdullah. Nevertheless, there's a difference of opinion whether one of them has the same two names or whether there was only three of them. So these were the sons of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all the children that he bore were given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Khadijatul Kubra radiallahu anha, except for his son Ibrahim that he bore from Maria Qibtiya radiallahu anha. So Zainab radiallahu anha, this particular daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Khadija radiallahu anha, she was married to a man. So by the permission of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Khadija radiallahu anha got her married to Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah. Abu al-As was a very noble man. He was a very honest man, and he was a great tradesman as well. He was a businessman, and his honesty and his business was known. It was well known amongst the people. So Khadija radiallahu anha sought consent from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam whether or not their daughter Zainab radiallahu anha could be married to this individual Abu al-As bin Rabi'ah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's consent is given. The marriage takes place. Now, later on, Zainab radiallahu anha would of course embrace Islam, whereas Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah would not embrace Islam. He would continue with his old ways, the ways of shirk. His daughter has now embraced, Rasulullah's daughter, so the wife of Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah, she's accepted Islam. But he himself has not, until now, he has not accepted Islam. He is going to stick to shirk. Nevertheless, Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah, when he was married to her, the people used to come to him from the Quraysh, and they used to instigate, and they used to tell him in an evil manner, why don't you divorce the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Zainab, just like Abu Lahab's two sons have divorced two of the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Both Ruqayya and Ummi Kulthum, both of these daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam were married to the two sons of Abu Lahab. Okay? So both of them were divorced by the sons of Abu Lahab at one and the same time. So the people used to use this to come to him, to Abu al-As ibn Rabi, and say, look, Abu Lahab did it. I mean, both of his sons did it. Why can't you do it too? Why don't you divorce the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Abu al-As ibn Rabi, though he was not a Muslim, he is a mushrik, he is a polytheist, associates and ascribe partners unto Allah, he said, I will not be able to fancy another woman. I don't desire another woman after Zainab radiallahu anha because of how noble Zainab radiallahu anha is. She's a Muslim. He's not a Muslim. But he attests to the fact, he makes it clear that I won't find anybody like Zainab radiallahu anha again. I don't want to go around looking for anybody because I won't find anybody like Zainab radiallahu anha. Nevertheless, he was also amongst those people that were captured by the Muslims in the Battle of Badr, and he was taken as a prisoner of war. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had ordered these individuals who were captives to present the payment of ransom for in exchange for which they will be released, Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha came. She came. And when Zainab radiallahu anha came, she intended on paying the ransom for the release of her husband, Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah. And what did she have with her at the time? All she had to present to the Muslims was a necklace that was gifted to her by Khadija radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at the time when she had been wedded, when she had been married to Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is collecting the payment that the people need to make for their ransom, he sees this necklace and he remembers, he recognizes the necklace and he starts to remember Khadija radiallahu anha. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, tears begin to come into his eyes. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam requested the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, if you people allow me, return this necklace to Zainab radiallahu anha. This is the necklace of the late Khadijatul Kubra radiallahu anha. Return this necklace to Zainab and release Abu al-As ibn Rabi'a if you people want. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa requested the Sahaba. Sahaba radiallahu anhu replied, Ya Rasulullah, anything for you. Return the necklace, release Abu al-As ibn Rabi'a. Done. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only requested it. It's their right. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu didn't have to accept. It's theirs. It's ransom that has to be paid by the disbeliever. Anybody that's going to ransom him, that's the money, this is the amount, then you're free. If not, you continue to be held by the Muslims as a prisoner of war. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam requested it. Sahaba radiallahu anhu, for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, anything. Done. That's it. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then requested Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah, we let you go. No need to pay the ransom, it's fine. However, when you get back to Madinatul Munawwara, you promise me that when you get back to Makkah, you promise me that you will send my daughter Zainab radiallahu anha to us in Madinatul Munawwara. Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah, he said, guaranteed. I give you my assurance, O Nabi of Allah, that I will go back to Mecca, and as soon as I get to Mecca, I will prepare Zainab radiallahu anha, the camel and everything that she needs, and I will dispatch her to Madinatul Munawwara. Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah, he's released. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's son-in-law, Zainab radiallahu anha's husband. He's released, comes back to Mecca. The first thing that he does when he gets to Mecca, the first thing that's on his mind is the word that he has given to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's made him a promise. What is it? I will send my wife, I will send Zainab radiallahu anha right away to Madinatul Munawwara to join you. So what does he do? He prepares the camel, he prepares everything that he needs for Zainab radiallahu anha's journey to begin from Makkah to Medina. And with her, he sends his brother, Kinana bin Rabi'ah. Kinana bin Rabi'ah, a very great gentleman, a very great, generous, gracious man. He is prepared with Zainab radiallahu anha, the caravan or the camel, everything is ready, and they are dispatched. Just as they left Makkatul Mukarramah, the Quraysh are informed. And the Quraysh saw in the middle of the afternoon, broad daylight, Kinana bin Rabia and Zainab radiallahu anha bint al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they said, there's no way we're going to let you leave. This is not going to happen in so much ease. You think you're going to leave just like this in broad daylight? We don't have a problem. You're going to go join your father in Medina Munawwara, that's fine. But the problem that we have is you're leaving. You're so open about it. You think in broad daylight, Abu Sufyan was there too. Abu Sufyan and the chief of the Quraysh, they don't like this. What is this? You're so brazen, you're just going to leave and we're all watching you and the sun is shining and nothing's going to happen? No. So what they said was, we'll let you leave. However, do it in such a manner that nobody is to find out. They don't want to harm their reputation, their pride, their ego. You leave in the middle of the night when everybody's asleep, take off. But don't leave now, everybody's going to see and they're going to say, oh, the Quraysh, they didn't do nothing. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's daughter left Medina Munawwara, left Mecca to come to Medina, and they didn't do nothing about it. They said, this is what we have a problem with, and this is what we don't want you to do. This is exactly what happens. So now, Kinana bin Rabi has to go back to Mecca with Zainab radiallahu anha. On their way back, they're not going in the direction of Medina anymore, they're coming back to Mecca now. A man by the name of Habbar ibn Aswad. We have to be careful because now he's going to make a big mistake, but later on he becomes a Sahabi. What did he do at this time? He terrified, he threatened Zainab radiallahu anha. And it was so terrifying, whatever it was that he said to her or whatever it was that he may have done at that time. He scared her, he terrified her so much so that she was pregnant at the time and there was a miscarriage. Habbar bin Aswad. So Zainab radiallahu anha has a miscarriage. Ultimately she has to go back. After a few days, when Kinana bin Rabia, her brother-in-law, her husband's brother, after a few days when he comes back to Makkatul Mukarramah at nighttime, just like he was advised to do so by the Quraysh, they prepare the camel, she mounts the camel, and off they go. They would leave until they come to Madinatul Munawwara, and there they meet with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. After this entire incident that takes place, about 2 days later, they reach Madinatul Munawwara. So before they could actually get to Madinatul Munawwara, they stopped at a place called Batniya Juj. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed two sahaba, one Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anhu, and the other was an Ansari sahabi, a sahabi from amongst the Ansar of Madinatul Munawwara. They had been sent by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the direction of Mecca. So here Kinana bin Rabi is coming from Mecca to Medina, and then here Zayd bin Haritha and this Ansari sahabi are coming from Medina. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, when you come to Batni Ya'juj, you then will there meet Zainab radiallahu anha. Take Zainab radiallahu anha and bring her with you, along with you, to Madinatul Munawwara. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa knew exactly what's happening, where they are at this time. So exactly when they reached Batni Ya'juj, that is when these two, Kinana bin Rabia and Zainab radiallahu anha, had reached there as well. They then took Zainab radiallahu anha and then continued moving in the direction of Madinatul Munawwara until they reach Madinatul Munawwara. When they come to Madinatul Munawwara, so then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is there and Zainab radiallahu anha is with him. She has been reunited with her father, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Meanwhile, Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'a, he is still in Mecca. So the wife, the daughter of the Prophet ﷺ, with him in Madinatul Munawwara. Whereas Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'a, he is still in Mecca. Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'a was known to the people. His honesty, his skill in business was known. He had the reputation. So there was a trade caravan that he was leading, or perhaps he was a part of, which was going from here to Syria, to Bilad al-Sham. And because the people had so much reliance on him, everybody had invested. Everybody had put their capital into this trade caravan with Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'. He's leading the caravan. He's the one that's been entrusted with the capital of all the people. The people have invested their money in him. He's going to Syria. He's coming back. He's going to bring back a lot of profit. He had taken people's possessions, people's things, people so much. So he goes off to Syria, Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'. And then when the same caravan that he was in is returning to Mecca, they were waylaid by a group of the Muslims. They were attacked. They were taken, they were robbed, so to say, by the Muslims. The Muslims took them, captured them. Not robbed them, captured them. And now that they were captured by the Muslims, Abu al-As bin Rabi'ah was amongst them as well. So Abu al-As bin Rabi'ah, he managed at that time to escape. Everybody else in the caravan, their caravan, the goods, the merchandise, everything was seized by the Muslims. When the Muslims took care of that caravan, they took everything away. The one who manages to escape, Abu al-As bin Rabi'ah, he leaves, he runs away. Where does he go? He comes straight to Madinatul Munawwara, where his wife, Zainab radiallahu anha, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are. When he comes at the time, Zainab radiallahu anha goes for Fajr Salah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is leading the Salah. And Zainab radiallahu anha makes an announcement after the Salah that I have given sanctuary, I have given safety and protection to Abu al-As bin Rabi'ah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned around and he asked the Sahaba, "Sami'tu ma sami'tu?" Did you people hear what I just heard? That Zainab has given protection, safety, sanctuary to her husband. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said at this time that even the lowest level Muslim, the Muslim of the lowest rank, he can give sanctuary to anybody he wants. So he accepted this protection that was offered by Zainab for Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'ah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then told Zainab, "You can honor him. It's excellent that you've given him your safety, your sanctuary, protection. However, you are not allowed to become intimate with him. He is no longer your husband. He is a mushrik and you have accepted Islam." So when this happened, Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'ah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then told the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, "You people know my connection with him. You know that he is my son-in-law. He was married to my daughter Zainab radiallahu anha." And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they acknowledged. And he said to the Sahaba who had waylaid, they had taken that merchandise and seized all the goods from that caravan that he was with. That was the merchandise and goods that people had entrusted Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'ah with. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam requested the Sahaba to sympathize with him. "You know who he is to me. If you wish to keep everything that you have taken from him, rightfully so, it's yours. You are allowed to do so. It is a gift for you from Allah. But if you also wish, you may then return everything that you have taken from him back to him." Sahaba, again, Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Ya Rasulullah, all of it. Everybody came. One would return the bucket, one would return a rope, one would come and return a piece of leather. Everybody started returning everything that they had taken from them until all of his merchandise that he had taken had been returned. Abu al-As ibn Rabi'ah then left. And when he left, he went right back to his people that he had taken this stuff from. And he said, "Oh my people, listen very carefully. Have I returned to you everything that you people had entrusted me with?" They said, "Yes, you were a very honest man, you were a very noble man. And everything that we'd entrusted you with, everything has been given back to us. We have nothing to hold you accountable for. Everything that was taken by you has been given back." He says, "In that case, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله." I bear witness that there is nobody worthy of worship but Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. The only reason I waited for me to give all these things back to you people is that I was afraid that you people might say, "I still have what's yours. This is why I accepted Islam. I didn't want anybody to say anything of this nature. I've given you back everything that belonged to you. I bear witness that there is nobody worthy of worship but Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. Abu al-As bin Rabi'a accepts Islam. From the husband to the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's the husband of the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to a captive, a prisoner of war, and now he has become Abu al-As bin Rabi'a radiyallahu anhu wa ardaah. After this, number two, another individual who was also held as a captive, a prisoner of war, amongst the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, was the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib. Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, in the Battle of Badr, he had been captured by an individual by the name of Ka'b ibn Amr Abu al-Yusr. Ka'b ibn Amr Abu al-Yusr. This is the name of the Sahabi radiallahu anhu who captured Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib. Ka'b ibn Amr was a very scrawny guy, very small guy. Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib was strong, he had a huge structure. So people would think, how did you capture him? You're so small, you look so weak and frail, but this Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, his voice, just his voice used to reach 8 miles. The voice of Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, it's written in the books of history. 8 miles, he says something, 8 miles. He used to relay the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nevertheless, so Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the guy who had captured him, Ka'b ibn Amr radiallahu anhu, he said, how did you're so small, how did you manage to capture my uncle Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib? Ka'b ibn Amr says, wallahi, O Prophet of Allah, by the one who sent you with the truth, it actually wasn't me. There was another man who was helping me. And this is what the other man looked like. And this is what the other man was. And he started to describe. After he gave Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that description, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, verily, that was an angel who helped you. Because you would have never been able to catch Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib and been able to capture him. There was an angel who came to aid you and assist you at that time. Nevertheless, the shackles that they had put, something that they put on the feet of the prisoners of war, those shackles on the feet of Abbas, or the legs of Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, were very tight. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could see that he was in a lot of pain. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself was very displeased. He was very not happy, he was sad that his uncle had to go through this pain because those shackles were so tight. And Sahaba radiallahu anhum saw this. So he requested the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, if it's okay, can you just at least loosen them up a little bit? Don't make them so tight. They said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, forget just loosening them. We'll take them off and we'll release him. He's free if you tell us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, where that is, that is, the Ansar said, we will absolve our nephew, a very special word that they used. The Ansar referred to the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as their nephew. And they didn't say, your nephew. They said, our nephew. Abbas's father is Abdul Muttalib. Abdul Muttalib's mother was from the Ansar. So because Abbas is like one of the Ansar, Abbas, because his grandmother is from the Ansar, they were trying to show Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we'll release him, it's not a problem for us. And they didn't indicate towards, they didn't show the connection with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to indicate to him that we're doing you a favor. He's one of ours. We'll really understand the words that these people use. They don't want Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to feel that they're doing him a favor. They want him to feel, he's one of ours too. He's our nephew, he belongs to the Ansar. So we'll release him, we'll do him a favor, we're doing ourselves a favor. We're not doing you a favor yet. But yes, they're doing the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a favor, because that's his uncle and he's in pain seeing him in pain. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, then we'll ask him to pay the ransom amount. So Abbas, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked Abbas, you need to pay the amount to be freed. Abbas said, I'm sorry, I complain because I'm in poverty, I'm poor, I don't have the money. When Abbas said, I don't have the money to pay for my ransom, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Abbas, where is that treasure that you and your wife Ummi Fadl are hiding in Mecca? Abbas said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa annaka Rasulullah. Nobody else knew about this treasure except me and my wife. How do you know? You must be the messenger of Allah. Abbas became a Muslim. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he set the amount for Abbas. For him to be freed, it was 100 uqiyah of silver. Uqiyah is approximately, one uqiyah is 80. One uqiyah is 40 mithqals. And 40 mithqals is equal to 320 grams for one uqiyah of silver. So for Abbas, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stipulated 100 uqiyah. So that's, 32,000 grams of silver. It's a big amount. For Aqil, who is the brother of Ali, who is the son of course, Abu Talib, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said 80 uqiyah of silver. That's the amount that they have to pay to be freed. Abbas asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ya Rasulullah, why did you make it so high for me? We're family. I thought you would probably make it a little cheaper. Did you do it because we're family? Because sometimes you think if your family's running the business, if your family's in charge, if your family has the power, they give you a little discount. He said, why did you charge me so much? Why is my payment for ransom even? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse. Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu qul liman fi aydikum min al-asra. O Nabi, tell those people that are with you, the captives. إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا مِمَّا أُخِذَ مِنْكُمْ. Tell those people that are with you captives, Abbas, tell them whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes from you now, Allah will give you something greater in return. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. Abbas used to always say after that, Allah gave me something better in return. I paid 100 uqiyah of silver. Allah blessed me in this dunya with 100 slaves. Every single slave was a trader. He was a businessman. Allah blessed me with that in this world. And then Allah said, He will forgive me. I have hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me too. And after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with Islam, he paid only this amount. He says, I wish Allah would have taken from me, multiplied manyfold. If Allah would have taken 1,000 from me at that time to become free, Allah would have blessed me 1,000 times. Allah took 100, Allah blessed me 100 times. Inshallah, tomorrow we will continue. Stay tuned. We will continue with the story of Umayr ibn Wahab and Safwan bin Umayyah tomorrow, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.